Folks, welcome to the shop and the first of a series of what's going to be shop talk posts. Now, we're going to get everybody on the same page. This is going to be the first video we've done across a new platform. We're now doing a thing with Wrenchway, which in our opinion is really, if you're employed in the industry, if you're pulling wrenches for a living, it's what's been missing. And especially from a shop standpoint, because it's no big secret. The roles are reversed. The shops are, any shop, our shop, everybody's shop, dealer, independent, maintenance, full builds, it does not matter. We are recruiting talent, and there is far more jobs than talent. So in the balance of supply and demand, it's what you can offer the talent, not that often dictates the hiring situation. So we're going to go for a walk here. We're going to talk about some of that stuff because I don't want to do 20 minutes of video of you looking at me, and neither do you. So with that, we're going to talk today about electric power. That's the latest common thing. Everybody's talking about it. I get asked about it all the time. What are you going to do? You know, what's your stand on it? That sort of stuff. And there's one huge facet, one big thing that's missing from electric power that nobody seems to be talking about. So maybe I'm on my soapbox, but that's going to be the focus of this video. First and foremost, our stand on electric power is, or any alternative fuel, if they put it out there, we're going to fix it. I'm not afraid of it, not concerned with it. That's a scare tactic that dealerships will sometimes sell, that you need to be employed by the dealership, by the OE, to stay on top of the technology, blah, 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 blah. And I find it fear-mongering. I'm just not into it. I don't buy it. So that said, that's our stand. If they offer it, we're going to fix it. Now, and forgive us, the shop, we got some matte stuff going on, some paint. The place is a mess. We got yeah, a lot of work, a little shorthanded, but you know, bear with me. You know, it is a shop. We work here. It's not the it's not a Taj Mahal, you know, as they refer to the ones where you park your boat. This isn't that. Back to my point, which I deviated heavily from. Electric power. Now, number one, the biggest thing I say about electric power is if you're going to see mass adoption, if you're going to see mass acceptance, if capitalism is going to engage in it, it has to be the one thing a modern diesel isn't. And a modern diesel... And it doesn't matter who made it. Cummins, Packard, Scania. A modern diesel is not reliable. There's too much going on. There's too many sensors, too many systems that reliability will never be what it once was. Never. And capitalism to accept electric, that's what I feel it's missing. It needs to be reliable. And I think it well will be. The technology is pretty basic. The only thing we're really missing is the power distribution and the battery, the storage technology. And that's still an issue. It's going to continue to be an issue. You know, we're going to see it for short route, inner city, where the start and stops are there, where the mileage... I think it's going to be a long, long time, if ever, before we see mass adoption of over the road. Wow, blank that thought. I'm not editing this. It's a blog. You're going to get what you get. But, so electric being reliable. There's nothing really to it. You've got, you know, basic technologies, motor windings, etc., transformers, stuff that's been around for decades, over a century. And the basics of the electric vehicle is going to be wheel motors or motor. I'll get into that in a second. Battery or power source, transformer, controller, and lines. That's it. And it's all electronic based. So you're going to see the ability of it to fire code for an indication of a problem is there. You know, it's going to be codes and issues, and that's it. Nothing to it. And oh, the wheel motor part, trailing back to that, I thought it would be, and I still think it'll get to this, independent wheel motors, left, right, front drive, rear drive, because you have, you're eliminating a bunch of parts. You're eliminating the rotating mass of the differential, all that action. I think the way that most OEs are doing it now with a single motor into a differential housing and all that extra mass and parts, I think that's going to go away. If you do individual wheel end motors, you instantly have an integrated capacity to do limited slip control through wheel speed left, right, and integrated traction control, differential locking, analog brake strategies. You know, all that stuff is just going to be right there if you do individual wheel motors. I don't know why. I would guess it's probably something silly like product acceptance or burning up old inventory with axle housings, etc. Why they're doing that like that, I don't know. I don't get it. So your basic parts, your wheel motor, you know, you'll have a transformer that varies voltage, amperage. That'll be your directional control. Battery pack supply, obviously, the lines going to it. And a controller that takes your all your inputs, your CAN bus data, that sort of stuff. Now, you've listed, what, half a dozen components? And this is the part that nobody's talking about. The death of the diagnostician. Those parts, they're electronic in nature. They're modular. And I see all the time an OE dealership level. You become a slave to engineering. You call them up. Engineering looks at the codes and the log files. They say replace this part. That's it. Well, the bulk of the people I know that I want to work with in this sort of stuff, that is not what we want to do. We are a figure it out, driven, motivated type of people. So, but that leads back to the labor shortage. This is going to be an answer to an attempt to eliminate the super high-skilled, high-wage job technician jobs. And that might be a pretty unpopular opinion. It's for darn sure pretty scary. But the motor, transformer, battery pack, package, it's all modular. It's going to be a bunch of bolts and change this part out, which is going to drive, you know, you're still going to need a body, a person to do it, but you've driven the skill set way down, especially from where we're at now, because we are at a technological peak high in the demands and the requirements of a technician, of a proper diagnostician. The books, the troubleshooting trees, and sometimes they're 20, 30 pages. Guys that are doing this for a living, you know what I'm talking about. You know, that's all downtime, warranty claim stuff. That's all what they're trying to get rid of at a manufacturer level. Because at the end of the day, the equipment manufacturer, and it again, Packard, Navistar, Freightliner, man, doesn't really matter. It's capitalism. They're there to make money. And regardless of what they tell you us or what they're telling us now, they are not there to make jobs. Jobs are the necessity of making money. The more of those jobs that they can eliminate, you know, as long as it's capital effective, that's what they're going to do. This is an EPA04 to EPA04 Cummins to CAT swap, by the way. That should be a pretty good time. I guess I kind of wandered around here knowing what's going on and not really explaining it. Painting an engine here and doing some work for a truck show. You know, it's Sunday, so there isn't near as many projects going on, but it's still a mess. The shop truck, which if you have one of these trucks, don't ever buy an aluminum heater core. My God, we've been through, I think, close to 10 of them. And we've even torn the heads back off it, trying to figure that out. But back to the note at hand, you know, that's taken from indications that I see in a lot of industries. It's not just ours. So if you're into the industry, if you're passionate, if you care about it, if it's who you are, that's something to think about. A lot of the reverse side of that is the resistance to that. You know, I wanted to touch on that. We're seeing EPA 04 stuff bring six-digit figures pretty consistently. And even some 40-year-old truck rebuilds are becoming viable. This is Project Ducky. This is the one I bought out of Nebraska sight unseen. The frame is pretty rocky. Some triple terrain in spots, but we'll get into all that back when we get onto our regular scheduled programming. Real interesting story with this truck. A whole episode in and of itself that we'll get into there, but that's about what I've got, at least for 12 minutes of unhinged Sunday morning rambling. This is interactive. If you go to wrenchway.com and you want to see our shop profile at Motzke Diesel, you can type that in a radius, and we are a Top Shops sponsored listing. Listing's not the right word. Profile partner with Wrenchway. We'll be starting an interactive discussion there with that, and even a comment section, YouTube, that sort of stuff. I'd like to see what everybody's thoughts are on that, and not just if you're employed in the field. You know, polar one way or the other, I imagine there'll be some pretty strong thoughts on that, which is okay if you don't agree with me. If I'm an idiot off my rocker, you know, that's there's opinions other than my own, and that's totally fine. I'm not so naive as to think that I've got it all figured out. Or, you know, where do we go from here? Is the hydrogen, I see that as a long-term for OTR, which is I'm placing a bunch of eggs in that basket in the future for diagnostician type work, personally. But that's about it. Thanks for watching. You know, let's interact, let's discuss.